Planning Center. This, of course, will probably be, or may be, the only opportunity here in Southern California where the candidates could express their views. This is a 90-minute live program, which means that at 7 o'clock, which is about 4.5 minutes from now, we will begin. We have taken questions from online, as well as from the different sponsoring organizations. There will not be any live questions from the audience. We will take card questions from the audience and provide them to the sorting table over here. And that way we will be able to take questions from you in the audience. But there will be no live questions taken during the program, except for one of our students, as well as, in fact, we have a group of students from where? Bellflower, right? Where are you? Right there? Thank you. And so again, to let you know, this will be a 90-minute program. We have about 2.5 minutes to go. And so once we begin, we'll just keep going. So again, please enjoy yourselves. Thank you very much again for attending. And we hope you have an informative as well as an entertaining career. Thank you. We have 1 minute to go, and as usual, this is the same admonition. Please turn off your cell phones or make them do things so we can't hear them. All right, thank you very much, and we have about 45 seconds to go.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Los Angeles County Office of Education. My name is Art Delgado, and I'm the superintendent of the Los Angeles County Office of Education. On behalf of the Los Angeles County Office of Education, it's our honor and pleasure to co-host Candidates Forum for the Office of the California Superintendent of Public Instruction. I'm glad to see a great turnout. We have with us this evening an assembly of strong advocates for educational excellence. Thank you all for joining us tonight. I also want to give a great thank you to our candidates, Superintendent Tom Torlakson and Mr. Marshall Tuck. Welcome for giving us an opportunity to learn more about your vision for educational leadership in California. Your insights into the various challenges our education communities are facing and how you view the role of the superintendent of public instruction. Thank you as well to our co-host, the Los Angeles County School Trustees Association, and I'd also like to acknowledge our partners and co-sponsors of this forum, the League of Women Voters of California Educational Fund and the California State PTA. Our panel members who represent these organizations will be introduced by
our audience guys to see
this program. Well, this is our really to provide our education communities an opportunity to get to know candidates and where they stand on critical issues.
that many people here, actually.
Providing this kind of leadership and advocacy on key educational issues is very much in keeping with the many vital functions of the County Office of Education. These functions also include educating our county's most vulnerable students and providing fiscal oversight and a wide range of additional support services to our county's 80 school districts. We do this in concert with our partners, school board members from the Los Angeles County Trustees Association, and many of you, I'm sure, have pressing questions for our candidates, and like you, I'm intensely interested in hearing a lively exchange of ideas here this evening. And I'll be jotting down notes just like all of you will be tonight. The challenges facing Californian education are formidable. And I think we are fortunate to have our two candidates here tonight to share their thoughts on these challenges with us here in this place, in this room, as well as with those that will be with us as part of our TV audience. Through the California Channel. So now let me turn this over to our moderator, Janice Hirohama, and Vice President of the League of Women Voters of California Education Fund.
Thank you, Dr. Delgado. Hello, and I'm very pleased to serve as the moderator for this candidates forum for the Office of California Superintendent of Public Instruction. Superintendent of Public Instruction is a nonpartisan, statewide, constitutional office. Superintendent is responsible for the day-to-day operations of the California Department of Education, CDE, which oversees the public school system and administers and enforces state education laws. Superintendent's job is to implement decisions of the legislature and the State Board of Education. In a very real sense, then, Superintendent is responsible for the education of more than 7 million children and young adults in more than 9,000 schools across the state. As noted by Dr. Delgado, today's forum is hosted by the Los Angeles County Office of Education and the Los Angeles County School Trustees Association, in co-sponsorship with the League of Women Voters of California Education and the California State Youth. We are being cablecast live by the California Channel and streamed live on the California Channel website, calchannel.com. This is a nonpartisan educational candidates. None of the hosting or co-sponsoring organizations endorse, support, or oppose any candidate for public office. Today, you'll be hearing from the two candidates who will appear on the ballot for Superintendent of Public Instruction in the November general election. Both candidates have agreed to the ground rules. I would now like to introduce the candidates to you. The candidates you will vote on today are Tom Torlakson, California Schools Superintendent, and Marshall Tuff, Educator. The questions that will be asked of our candidates this evening come from three sources, those submitted prior to the forum by members of co-sponsoring organizations, those submitted by our live audience, and those submitted by home viewers via email. For those of you watching the program live, you can email questions to forum@lacoe.edu. Questions are reviewed by representatives of the co-sponsoring organizations to make sure they are relevant, are not duplicative, and follow the agreed-upon guidelines and ground rules. Questions focus on mission. Personal or individually targeted questions or attacks on any candidate are not used or considered. Let me explain the format. Format for the forum will be as follows. Each candidate will give a 90-second opening statement. After the opening statements, there will be a first round of questions and answers. In that round, the first question will be asked by Superintendent Delgado and the second question by a student. The rest of round one will be devoted to questions submitted prior to the forum by members of the co-sponsoring organization. All questions will be answered by both candidates. Each candidate will have 1 minute to answer each question. The order of candidates will be rotated between the candidates. As a reminder to the candidates, the timers will give you a 15-second warning before your time is up. When you see the stop sign, please finish your sentence and stop. The second round of questions will be asked by a panel of representatives from the hosting and co-sponsoring organization. And I would like to introduce that panel now. First, Dr. Arturo Delgado, Superintendent of Schools, representing the Los Angeles County Office of Education. Linda Wong, representing the Los Angeles County School Trustees Association. Marilyn Bushy, representing the League of Women Voters of California Education Fund. And Kathy Moffitt, representing the California State ETA. Again, both candidates will answer each question and will have 1 minute each to respond. In the third and final round of questioning, the candidates will answer questions that were written or emailed by the audience or submitted before the forum by members of the sponsoring organization. After all three rounds of questions and answers are completed, each candidate will have 2 minutes to comment, rebut, augment, clarify any topic raised in the forum. They will speak in the reverse order of their opening statement. We ask you in the audience, please hold your applause until the end of the forum. That will keep the proceedings impartial and allow us to ask as many questions as possible. Before we start, I'd like to acknowledge the volunteers assisting with timing, question sorting, and other essential tasks. They are members of the League of Women Voters and the 33rd District PTA, working with the Los Angeles County Office of Education and the Los Angeles County School Trustees Association. So, we're ready to begin. The order of the first question was determined by random drawing, and the order will alternate throughout the forum. And we'll start with Mr. Torlakson. You have 90 seconds for your opening statement.
Thank you, and great to be here. Thank you, Superintendent Delgado, the League of the PTA. I'm a teacher. I'm a coach. I want to see that every single student thrives, has self-confidence, and can achieve their dreams. That's what I'm all about. It takes teamwork. We have a long way to go. We have a lot of work to do. But together, we're making real progress. For instance, we've raised graduation rates in California to an all-time high, 80%. The key to lasting improvements is to invest in our schools. Stopping the cuts means smaller classes, means stronger academics, means expanding career education, means bringing back art, music, and drama to our schools. We're also putting more decisions in the hands that belong at the local level, at our school level, where teachers, parents, and community leaders can set priorities, not politicians in Washington or in Sacramento. And of course, it takes more than money. Students need to be safe. I've written laws to prevent bullying. I've written laws to create 4,000 after-school programs in the state of California. And we need great teaching in every school. I helped pass a law this year to make it easier to fire abusive or ineffective teachers. But I also believe experienced teachers deserve a fair hearing when their job is on the line. We're making real progress. This is not the time to take a step backwards, put that progress at risk. Our students get only one chance at a great education. Working together to help our students achieve their dreams. Let's do that. Work together.
Thank you. Now the opening statement for Mr. Tuck. You have 90 seconds.
I also want to thank our co-sponsors. I want to recognize the students. The high school students are here with us tonight. Appreciate you guys coming and taking your time. I left my job in the technology sector about 12 years ago to get an education full time. Because I believe there's nothing more important to giving kids a better life than giving them a quality education. I helped create Green Dot Public Schools. We work with charter high schools in the high-speed areas of LA. And our students are graduating college ready at 4 times the rate of neighborhood students. I then went to work for former LA Mayor Villaraigosa, who took over the lowest performance schools in Los Angeles. Great kids, but failing schools. And I'm proud to say our kids, after 5 years, had the highest improvement of any school system in the state of California with more than 10,000 students. But doing this work day after day, I became convinced that we will never educate all kids in our state until we change the status quo in Sacramento. We are the wealthiest state in the nation, and our schools ranked 45th in math and reading. And 20 years ago, we were 44th. We need to be better for our kids, and we've got to make changes now. And if you look most recently at what's wrong in Sacramento, it starts, you can see clearly in the Mubarak case. 9 students had to file a lawsuit against the state superintendent and against the state to get rights to a quality education. And a judge said the laws around 2-year tenure and supervised layoffs and dismissal process, they shock the conscience in terms of impact on high poverty kids. And yet the state superintendent and the state is appealing that case. we need to change now. It does not make sense for kids. We have to put kids first, and that's why every major newspaper in this state has endorsed our campaign.
Thank you. The audience can please hold their applause until the end of the forum. Help us move along. We're now ready to move into round one, and the first question will be asked by Superintendent Delgado.
Thank you. Here's the first question. At the state level, we have the State Board of Education, we have the California Department of Education, the Superintendent of Public Instruction, and the governor. If decisions are to be made at the local level, how do you include frontline educators who want their voices heard in this process?
And we'll start with Mr. Torlakson at 1 minute.
Well, frontline teachers need to be involved. That is absolutely for sure. We have a process of doing that now, and another process I initiated. We create a collaborative. We have frontline educators, administrators, and teachers going to be sitting down with my department and looking together and with teachers at how we can help prioritize the solutions for our schools. And this is one way. The local control funding formula, which I strongly supported, the governor championed, is a major new day in education. It allows for teachers to be involved and educators to be involved at the local level, setting priorities. Again, not by Washington, not by Sacramento, but by that authority deciding at the local level. So we're in a new day, moving in the right direction in that regard.
Thank you. Mr. Tuck, 1 minute.
Sacramento sort of needs to start by making every single decision based on one very clear thing: what is best for kids. And right now, there are way too many decisions being made in Sacramento by politicians and not being made by teachers and principals and parents and local school communities at their schools. And that's what needs to happen. In the schools I led, we pushed as much responsibility as possible to those that work in schools. Right now, our state, we have a 2,300-page book called the California Education Code. It is the visual definition of bureaucracy. It is the counter of truly empowering educators to do their job. We need to truly give real empowerment to local school communities. You can see it over and over again. You can see it in the Vergara ruling where the state ruled instead of supporting educators. You can see it in terms of the state now saying there is a cap on local district reserves and not letting school districts locally make those decisions. These are decisions that the state superintendent and the state over and over and over again is not truly giving local control and isn't prioritizing kids.
Thank you. The second question will be asked by Kristen Thompson, a student from Bellflower High School. Kristen, please come forward to pose your question.
Do you think independent of your grade or GPA should be admitted into the AP class? Do you think this is setting them up for failure if their past performances have indicated they may not perform well?
And we'll start with Mr. Chair.
First, thank you again for coming out and taking your time to ask this question. A student voice in our schools is essential to having a great school in our state. The question was around AP classes. I believe that every single child needs to have access to AP classes at the high school level. I also believe that we bring fundamental changes to our schools to ensure that we're preparing our kids to be successful in those AP classes. What I saw in the schools that we led is we had additional time for our kids who were behind in reading, who were behind in math, in their early years in school so they could actually catch up, and then we truly gave them those opportunities to have access to those core courses and AP courses that we know all kids have access to, and we need to make sure all kids have access in all communities. So I absolutely believe that kids need to have access to those courses, and that the state has a responsibility to make sure they are supporting local schools, supporting local school decision making, so we are preparing our children to be successful in those classes and not send them up for failure. But first and foremost, Kids First says, give access to all kids in those areas.
Thank you. Mr. Torlakson.
And I would agree, and I thank you again for coming forward with your question. We want to provide that access for all students. We want all of our students to be college and career ready. And one of the major reforms I've helped champion and help implement is the local control funding formula, where we're putting billions of dollars in the communities where the kids have the greatest need, where the students have the greatest opportunities to advance. And so English learners, kids in poverty, we want to make sure that their schools provide those opportunities. And we early on, just starting from the very beginning, early learning before kindergarten and on through, support our students so they can be proficient in this language, so they can be competent and move forward and take those AP courses. California is making strides in having those courses more accessible and in having more students take them. We want to see it much more ubiquitous around the state of California. I support your goals.
Thank you. We will now ask a series of questions submitted in advance of today's forum by members of the co-sponsoring organization. To start off, we have two questions instruction if elected. So, first question. Although the superintendent of public instruction, public education's only statewide constitutional officer in California, too many voters don't know what the position is or what it does. Please let our audience know what you see as your most important responsibility if elected to serve in that office for the next 4 years. A reminder, each of you has 1 minute to answer, and we'll start with Mr. Corbett.
We need to continue to invest in our schools. When I took over 4 years ago, our finances and our education system were in shambles. Schools were laying off tens of thousands of teachers. We saw very important programs dismantled and curtailed. And so my goal was to correct the finances in the state of California and return to investing in the future. That was my key and top priority. And we went from 188 school districts that were in severe financial trouble down to only a handful of those. So we got the public's attention to what was happening, what was harmful, and said, let's invest in our schools, and then we'll have lower class sizes, stronger academics, more opportunities for career education, and we've been able to invest that. I am excited about where we're going in the new 21st century skills. I helped get $1 billion to help implement that, get the computers and bandwidth into our schools, get the professional development. It's an exciting time of real change and reform that's opening opportunities to students as never before in California.
Thank you. Mr.
Tucker. The state superintendent's top responsibility is to be an independent leader for kids and for parents, and make sure that when there are policy decisions being made in Sacramento, that we are leading with a clear vision around what makes the most sense for kids, what makes the most sense for parents, and how to enable teachers and principals to make the key decisions locally in their school community. And that is not happening right now. It is not happening right now. When you have a lawsuit where students are filing suit against the state superintendent and against the state, and the state is fighting those students, that is not leading on behalf of kids, and that is happening in our state way too often, and we need fundamental change. So I believe that leadership starts with setting a real vision for what's possible for California kids, and that vision is we can be better than 45th. We got to get right back to the top, and it's possible, and you fight every single day to do whatever you can, both in your power and outside your power, to drive the change in California's need. Know that our kids deserve and need to have, and that to me is the role of the state superintendent. Every single decision, kid first, kid focused.
Thank you. A follow-up question. With the state budget determined by the governor and the legislature, and policy determined by the State Board of Education, what can you do to improve public education in California? Where can you have the strongest influence? Mr. Tucker.
State superintendent can do a lot. First and foremost, we talked about it before, but let's talk about what's possible legally. There was a lawsuit that sued the state superintendent, the Vergara suit. If I'm state superintendent, the first day in office, I'm actually changing sides, I'm siding with the kids right away, and you can do that legally and change the tide of things. Second,